In this video, we're going to begin our discussion of energy for life, oftentimes referred to as energy metabolism. Metabolism is all of the thousands and thousands of chemical reactions occurring in each of the 75 trillion cells in your body. And metabolism can be broken down into two separate parts. One part of metabolism is referred to as anabolism, and it is taking simpler substances, as you see here, and building them into more complex substances. Anabolism requires that we put energy in to make it occur, and for that reason we refer to it as an endergonic process or endergonic chemical reactions. The other part of metabolism is catabolism, and here we're taking the larger biomolecules and we're breaking them down into simpler substances. And you can see that in catabolic reactions, energy is released, and we refer to those as exergonic in nature. Quite often, the energy from an exergonic reaction is used to drive an endergonic reaction. And when that occurs, we refer to these as coupled reactions. And that's what you can see being illustrated here in this figure. The larger dark blue wheel represents an endergonic reaction turning clockwise and releasing energy as we break down the reactants. That energy is used to turn this wheel counterclockwise, and it builds simpler products into something more complex, and it's endergonic. And I'd like you to notice that the exergonic wheel, in fact, is larger than the endergonic wheel. That's because no chemical reactions are 100% efficient, and some energy is always lost as heat, and that means that we need to release more energy in the exergonic reaction than is required to drive the endergonic reaction. Coupled reactions that play a particularly important role in energy metabolism are oxidation-reduction reactions, or redox reactions. And I hope you remember from chemistry that redox reactions involve the transfer of electrons from one substance to another substance. And so here we have our beginning product, or our reactants. And electrons from substance A, typically carried by one or two hydrogens, are transferred to substance B. And here we have the end products of our chemical reaction. And you can see that B now has picked up electrons. Again, typically those electrons are carried by one or two hydrogens. I want you to keep in mind that anytime we have a transfer of electrons, we also have a transfer of energy. And so the truth is that reduced compound B now has more energy than the oxidized compound B had. And that's because of the transfer of the electrons. There are a couple of mnemonics you can use to remember what's going on in a redox reaction. One is Leo goes Gr. Leo is lose electrons oxidized. Gr is gain electrons reduced. If you prefer, you can use oil rig. Oxidized is lose, reduced is gain. A particularly important redox reaction in energy metabolism in humans involves the coenzyme NAD, which we also talked about during chemistry. NAD is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide. Now, in this particular diagram, they aren't showing you the electrons, but this hydrogen is carrying a couple of electrons, and they get transferred to the NAD, giving us NADH. You can see that in this case, one hydrogen is carrying two electrons. And again, the NADH now has more energy than the NAD had. Later on, the NADH will participate in other redox reactions, and they will transfer electrons to some other substance. And again, we'll also have a transfer of energy as that occurs. A question that we can ask is, why do humans need energy? The simple answer is, well, humans need energy to live. But if we're more specific, humans need energy in order to do biological work. And there are three types of biological work. The most obvious to us, because we see it every day, is mechanical work. Anytime you witness a friend move or you witness yourself move, you're witnessing mechanical work. In the picture to the right, you can see the young woman is lifting the weight off the floor. She's doing mechanical work on the barbell. Another type of work which we've talked about is transport work. And when we talked about moving substances across a cell membrane, we said that there are times when we have to take a substance and move it against its concentration gradient. We're taking sodium from inside the cell where it's in a very, very low concentration, and we're moving it to the outside of the cell where it's in a very high concentration. We're going against the concentration gradient, we're going uphill, and that requires us to put energy in to make that happen. The third type of biological work is chemical work, and translation is a perfect example of chemical work. Anytime we take simpler substances, like amino acids, and build them into something more complex, like polypeptides or proteins, we're doing chemical work. And again, that also requires the input of energy. You might also ask, where do humans get the energy to do biological work? And again, the simple answer is energy comes from the food that we eat. More specifically, it comes from the nutrients carbohydrate, fat, and protein. However, you need to keep in mind that energy in food is not used directly to do biological work. Rather, it has to be converted to the energy in a molecule of ATP. And you should remember from chemistry, again, that ATP is a nucleotide that's very, very important in energy metabolism. Here we can see the chemical structure of ATP, and here we can see kind of a schematic representation of it. Now, you should remember that the straight lines that you see here represent the covalent bonds between the individual elements in this particular molecule. However, if you look very, very closely, you'll see that there are two bonds that are not represented by straight lines, but rather by these squiggly lines or these tildes. And that's true in both the chemical structure and also in our schematic diagram. That's because these covalent bonds contain more energy than a typical covalent bond contains. And so when we hydrolyze this covalent bond, it releases a large amount of energy, and some of that energy is used to do biological work. So again, hydrolysis of ATP is an exergonic process. The other thing that you need to keep in mind is that cells have limited stores of ATP. There's not a whole lot there. And that means that we have to constantly replace the ATP that we've used to do biological work. The first law of thermodynamics tells us energy can't be created or destroyed, but it can be changed from one form to another form. And that's very, very beneficial for us. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. Well, what are the different forms of energy? There are six different forms of energy, not counting potential or kinetic. Why don't you pause the video now and see how many of the six forms you can identify? I hope that you were able to come up with at least some of these. Mechanical energy really is much like mechanical work. Anytime you see movement occurring, or anytime movement occurs even if you can't see it, for instance, your heart pumping and pushing blood, mechanical energy has been expressed. We've talked a little bit about heat energy, and we've said anytime there's a chemical reaction, some of the energy is lost as heat. That, in fact, is good for us because it helps to make it a little bit easier for us to maintain our core temperature at or near 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit. Of course, if you're exercising in high heat and high humidity, then it becomes a bit more problematic because we need to be able to dump excess heat so that we don't suffer from hyperthermia. You know that solar energy is required in order for you to be able to see. It's the energy in light which excites the rods and cones in the retina of the eye that allows you to see things like this video. We've already talked about chemical energy, and you know that the nutrients, carbohydrate, fat, and protein, contain chemical energy, as do the nucleotides ATP and ADP. You also know that your nervous system uses electrical energy to communicate with in various parts. It's also true that muscle requires electrical energy in order to be activated and contract. And then finally, we even find nuclear energy in the human body. In fact, a small proportion of all the potassium in your body is an unstable isotope of potassium. Because it's unstable, it breaks down and it releases nuclear energy. It's not clear that that particular nuclear energy serves any beneficial function. It may just be an artifact of having some unstable potassium in your body. Well, energy can't be created. Well, if that's the case, where does the energy for life on Earth come from? The answer is it comes from the sun. Remember, we can convert from one form to another form. We can convert from solar to other forms. Well, how is it that this occurs? And perhaps many of you have already answered that question. What is it that's shown in this diagram? Again, if you have to, pause the video and think about this for a minute or two and see if you can't come up with the answer. Well, I'm sure most of you have said, oh, well, this is illustrating photosynthesis. And you talked about photosynthesis back in middle school or high school at some point. I would like you to go ahead and write the equation for photosynthesis. And if you're unsure of what the equation is, if you look very carefully at the diagram, it will help you to figure it out. Here we can see CO2 in the atmosphere, and you can see that there are six of those. So the plant is able to take up six CO2 from the atmosphere. Down here, we see six water molecules. The plant takes those up through its root system. And then using energy from sunlight, the plant builds those into complex biomolecules, like monosaccharides. And what you see here is the monosaccharide glucose, which has the formula C6H12O6. And you could probably count those if you look very carefully. And then finally, produced as a byproduct is molecular oxygen. And again, you can see, oh, there are six of those. So when we put all of that together, here's the overall reaction for photosynthesis. Six CO2 plus six water plus energy of sunlight gives us glucose and six oxygen molecules. What's the reverse of photosynthesis? Again, take a few seconds or a minute or so to think about this and see if you can come up with the answer. Of course, the answer is that the reverse of photosynthesis is cellular respiration. And I do want you to know the overall equation for cellular respiration if you're taking this class with me. If you're taking this class on another campus, you should check with your professor to see if she wants you to know the overall equation for cellular respiration. And it's pretty easy. If you know the equation for photosynthesis, just take that arrow, flip it 180 degrees, and you have the equation for cellular respiration. And here we see a schematic representation of cellular respiration taken from your textbook. And so here we have our complex biomolecule, our glucose, C6H12O6. We require oxygen to be able to break it down. We're going to oxidize this molecule. We do that in a series of steps which release energy in small quantities. And we end up with the end products, six carbon dioxide and six water. And so you can see this is indeed the reverse of photosynthesis. Now, before we get into more detail looking at cellular respiration, which we'll do in the next video, I need to tell you that cellular respiration is not the only way that we get energy to replace ATP. We also have a molecule in the cells of our body known as phosphocreatine. Here you can see a schematic representation of phosphocreatine, and I hope that all of you have said, oh, look, there's a high energy bond. Well, if we hydrolyze that high energy bond, energy is released, and we'll use some of that energy to put a phosphate onto ADP, giving us more ATP. And I want you to recognize that putting a phosphate onto ADP is taking two simpler things and building them into something more complex. And so that's an example of chemical work. But it's an example of chemical work which is not driven by hydrolysis of ATP. There'll be a few other exceptions of biological work done not driven by hydrolysis of ATP, and I'll try to point those out to you as we go along.